I play Amy Menser, and she is a doctor within this secure lab. And she's, you know, she's a small team. It's one of eight. We are introduced to Amy in kind of like at the beginning of the film, whereby she is lying on Lee's bed, and Lee has just arrived and is kind of like settling in. And of course, being the possessive woman that she is trying to assert her power, trying to assert her her status. And it's very kind of like animalistic. She's there lying on Lee's bed, making her aware kind of physically that this is her domain, this is her territory, and no other kind of like young hussy is going to come in and kind of tamper with her routine and her love that she has for Morgan. I am, only because you're right, it's so close to the bone, isn't it? Because, I mean, yes, okay, this is fairly, you know, in the future and slightly futuristic, but, you know, there's reality here. There's very much human connection and human relations between all of us doctors and, you know, everyone in the research lab. And so you can relate to that on a very kind of present day way. And of course, kind of tweaking it here and there with artificial intelligence and that being, you know, very real right now in the world that we live in. And I think that exploring the technology and the science that we have behind that is, it's creepy because, well, I find it creepy just because, I don't know, I, you know, I'm a little bit kind of skeptical on where this should or will lead for us, I think, as a human race. But as a science fiction, I think that it's a very good kind of like platform to start from. Morgan as an AI, but more kind of like the relationship that she has with Amy, and trying not to make it so motherly, but kind of like bringing that back so that there's more kind of like narcissistic approach in the way that Amy loves Morgan because she is, like, she is mirroring who she is onto Morgan. And so there's a kind of like a scary kind of double-edged sword in the way that, okay, she loves Morgan because she can see herself reflected back at her. And she believes wholeheartedly that being the position that she is in and teaching her kind of like social skills and body language and behavioral issues, that, you know, she is helping Morgan grow from a young person. And therefore, having created who she is, you know, she feels that she's embodied Morgan with a soul. And so that, of course, comes all the way back to the possessiveness. And so Luke and I had like very, very interesting chats on that, and kind of like deep, kind of like in thought, kind of rehearsals and all of that. And so we kind of stayed more towards that really than the sci-fi element, which is brilliant because that then highlights the flaws within human nature. And so, you know, that kind of goes very, very deep within the psychology that we all have. And also, I think the fact that we are in this bubble, and we've been in this bubble for 5 years, for so goddamn long, that our sense of reality is completely diminished into where we are, into this, you know, this bunker, this building whereby we spend a lot of our days kind of like looking at Morgan as if she were this exotic fish, like behind this goldfish, kind of a gold, what is it, fishbowl. And I think that that very much highlights the fact that we have to have a purpose, so we have to, as the doctors, kind of like make this fly. And that's why we all are kind of crazy in our own world. And of course, Morgan being the brilliant, intelligent person that she is, like, sucks that up and gives off what she feels that Ted needs, and gives off what she feels that Kathy needs, and Amy, and responds to all of the different character traits. All this amazing machinery and technology that was surrounding us with, you know, wonderful screens of like brain scans and like monitoring the heartbeat and all of this, you know, very impressive kind of screens. And I thought, this has to be our world, this has to be kind of like where we live and breathe. And obviously it has been for 5 years, and so there needed to be a kind of natural ease into and around the space. And so we did a lot of rehearsal kind of like with the equipment, and I had to do, oh, this incredibly kind of like complicated maneuver on a keyboard, and then kind of like clicking the mouse, and I'm utterly useless. So we went over it and over it and over it so many times, because it had to be like butter. It had to just be like, oh yeah, she does this so often, then it's fine. But my God, I was like clicking and F1ing and F2ing and F3ing, and then back to the mouse, and then back to the typing something in, and it was too much. there are no boundaries, there are no limitations, and it trickles down, you know, from the top tier. And of course, particularly, you know, with Morgan, we can see that there are consequences, and that if something goes horrendously wrong, then, you know, corporate will step in. But you're right, you know, I think you become so warped within this world as a scientist that maybe, you know, you do begin to see collateral damage just be, well, no, that's another person, or that's another person. And you're so focused and kind of like embedded in getting it right because you've committed so many years to it that you almost, you become so warped that you then don't see life for being life and it's all encompassing. And I think that that is very dangerous.
Hey guys, now the trailer for my Big Fat Greek Wedding 2 is already out, but did you know that despite pulling in over 240 million, the first My Big Fat Greek Wedding never once topped the US box office chart? Now for this and more movie facts, click on more videos, but if you want something different, click on the playlist.